It's 7 o'clock in the evening at Finsbury Park in North London, and as all the nearby pubs are emptied, the first of 3,000 spectators are making sure of their seats, while officials make sure of their tickets, for a new and controversial form of a very old sport indeed. What they've come to see, at up to £12.50 a seat, is a boxing match which has been condemned by the local MP, largely ignored by the sporting press, has caused concern in some medical circles, and which has been refused a license by the British Boxing Board of Control. But unlicensed or unaffiliated boxing is now a growing phenomenon in the East End of London. And those involved are not at all impressed by official controls. They've come not for an exhibition of skill, according to the Queensbury rules, but for the spectacle of men past their prime having a punch-up. And there's one particular punch-up later tonight which everyone here has come to see. It's been billed as the close encounter for a third time for the unofficial heavyweight championship of Great Britain. In fact, it's a confrontation between two nightclub bouncers who, in certain circles in the East End, have both been well known for years. Lenny McLean, or Daddy Cool, as he's known by his associates, is defending his unofficial title.
I'll kill that Roy Shaw!
He started as a street fighter when he was still at school, eventually went to Borstal, and now supports himself by what's called minding a few clubs. His proudest achievement recently, he says, was taking on two gangs or firms of 15 troublemakers single-handed.
I knocked about six out. Pulled the sticks out, went to work, and the rest of them all run.
When you say pull the sticks out, what?
Well, you know, when you get a firm come after you about 15-handed, you've got to, you know, you got to use a stick, you know. We used to have a stick on the door, and we used to use that, you know. Because when people look for trouble, when they come in looking for trouble, you know, and they're determined, then you've got to hurt them, you know. When you say that was my job on the door anyway, but that's neither here nor there now. I'm into this fight game.
And what happened to the 15 people?
Well, I don't know. I'm not worried about them, as long as I wasn't hurt, you know.
But you were at that time.
Yeah, only me hands were, you know, were when I went into them. No marks on there, though, look. Is there?
And you knocked some of them out?
About six, seven. And the rest of them run. The rest of them run. Because they was cowards.
You sound a bit of a bully.
Nah, you're joking. Gentlemen. Not a bully. Gentlemen.
Roy Pretty Boy Shaw is McLean's opponent. He calls himself the Mean Machine, and he also has a wide following in the East End.
I have never yet seen a man relax his ears in a gym.
If either can't be found at certain pubs patronised by their supporters, they're usually visiting other well-known premises in their territory. In this case, second-hand car salesman near Ilford. Roy Shaw also started fighting at school. He escaped from Borstal and was in continual trouble with the police, which culminated in a 15-year prison sentence for the main part he played in a £90,000 armed robbery. He was so violent in prison that the authorities transferred him to 21 different institutions. They included Dartmoor, Broadmoor, and Maidstone, where the most serious incident of all took place.
No, I was irresponsible and a psychopath. I just couldn't help it in them days. I had so much energy in me that I just couldn't take anything from anybody. I couldn't take anybody telling me what to do or telling me off, you know. I just used to flare up.
And what happened to the cell door?
I just smashed right through it. They had to remove it and put another one on.
How did you do that?
I got it done with the chair and the bed. It's steel, but you keep smashing, the steel broke, and then it just split open. I mean, the doors are 800 years old, really, aren't they? It's only the metal that the old ones together, and the metal split, because it's only about a quarter of an inch metal plate on the inside.
Why did you do that?
Because they was provoking me, the prison officers.
In what way?
Well, they said I was drunk, and no way I could be drunk, but then they come up with the prison doctor, and they started saying, poke your tongue out. So I told them to go away.
Roy Shaw was persuaded to take up weightlifting in prison, and no doubt to everyone's relief, soon became a keep fit addict. When he was released, he was in immediate demand as a bouncer and also started training as a boxer, mainly at a gym in the Old Kent Road. In his early career, he once successfully applied for a license under an assumed name while he was on the run from the police and fought and won 10 professional fights. Later, when he reapplied, the Boxing Board of Control didn't believe his story that he'd been lagging pipes in Birmingham, and he's been refused professional licenses ever since. For his two principal East End backers, who've also been frozen out by the boxing establishment, it's all an unsporting constraint on an exciting revival of the ancient art.
It's a fight between two men who are going to fight. Both a strong man, both a fit man. No weaknesses without of these two men. And this will be a definite fight that the public want to see. It's by public acclaim. And the people know that they're not being brought in from abroad. They know that both men are strong, they're both Londoners. And the people who want to see the fights are the true sportsmen of the game. And as far as we're concerned, they're going to see a fight.
But it's an unlicensed fight.
Of course it's an unlicensed fight. It's an unaffiliated.
Unaffiliated.
Not unlicensed, unaffiliated.
But the boxers don't actually have licenses.
It's a word that the board uses this word license. And when you say someone's unlicensed, it seems as if it's illegal. But they should call it a permit. You know, they should look up what actual license means in the dictionary.
Roy Shaw's first big unlicensed fight was with Donnie the Bull Adams, whom he'd known in Dartmoor. They sold tickets for a bare-knuckle contest in a field, but were stopped by the police and each bound over for a year. Later, they met again in some circus quarters near Windsor, but to the fury of their supporting East End factions, the whole affair was over in seconds.
We know the rules, OK? Best of luck with the Perry. Off you go. Right, come on, let's go.
The only fight that was a bit dirty was when I fought Donnie Adams. I hit him when he was on the floor. Knocked him to the floor and he was on my knee and I hit him again. Several times, but that was in the agreement between me and him beforehand. We said anything goes as long as we don't bite or kick. So, without you know, a verbal agreement, I was in order. You know.
You've got to fight to get anywhere. You know, if you don't fight, you're just one of the crowd, and one of the crowd don't get nothing. So I started off as a kid fighting, and I was the best when I was a kid. And now I want to be the best now. That's why I do this fighting.
But what sort of fights were you involved in when you were a kid?
You know, street fights. And I'm just carrying on now, you know, just fighting. So I like fighting. But
when you say you had to fight to survive.
Well, you had to fight in the East End, didn't you? If you don't fight in the East End, you won't with the elbow, you get nothing. You know, you've got to survive in the East End. And,
so how did you manage to survive?
Be the best fighter. Be the governor. You know, I just picked up the paper one day, and, there was that, Shorey in the paper, saying, he's the governor, he's the best fighter in London. And I knew I could beat him. So a few friends and I got together, stuck a few quid up and challenged him.
In their first fight, McLean was beaten. He challenged Shaw again, and 5 months ago, there was a return match at a club in Croydon. More than 2,000 East Enders scented something out of the ordinary and were not disappointed.
son.
Well, he right looks a bit knackered to me.
Yeah, that right hand done it. That first right hander. That looks a punch.
He looks a bit knackered to me.
Roy Shaw now blames his rather spectacular defeat on the fact that before the fight, he was foolishly advised, he says, to take a particular form of herbal tea.
So I thought, well, on the night, what I'll do, I'll take more, so it'll make me feel stronger for the night. So on the night of the fight, about 3 hours before, I took four times the amount. But I didn't just take the capsules, I took the liquid stuff, which is the stronger. But what happens when you take over the amount? It sedates you. So really, I was sedated, and my wife could have knocked me over. That's how, you know, the start was. So when I got into the ring, I don't know if you saw the on the telly, the video of it. I stumbled up the ring. I didn't really know where I was, and when I got in there, I mean, I'm generally an aggressive fighter. I was standing there trying to box him. You can't.
Now, I've heard it said that you actually had stimulants, you had injections, you took special pills, and that was why you were slow.
No, I didn't have any injections or pills. All I took was the stuff called ginseng. That's all I took. That doped me up. It sedated me. All I needed was a jar on the head, and I was gone.
When I got in there nice and strong and fit, and knocked him out in 50 seconds, I hit him so hard he wound up in the second row.
He said he'd taken some. He was.
What he'd take? All he took was a right hander, and one up in the second row. And he's racking about. He took this and he took that. I don't care what he took. Monday night, I'll do the same again.
Why is it so important to beat him in this particular fight?
Well, I've got a bee in me bonnet about him.
He's just a tougher, you know, but as a fighter, I book him as nothing. I'll beat him easy this time. You'll see. It'll be a different fight inside.
It's a bit of a grudge fight. You know, he reckons he can beat me, and there's no way he can beat me. There's no way. You know, he's not strong enough. You know, I'll knock him out.
But why is it so important for you to beat him in this particular match?
It's just principle and pride. I'm a very proud man. I've never been beat in my life, and I don't aim to be beat by a mug like him.
Come on! Knock him back up to me.
Come on!
Both nightclub bouncers have trained hard for this coming fight, and there's no questioning their determination, if nothing else. Both men are somewhat reticent about the attitudes of their wives and families, and we've been discouraged from filming them, apparently for tax and security reasons.
Yeah.
Interest has been generated in almost every East End pub.
I think McLean's got two chances, dog's chance and no chance at all. I reckon Roy would do him two rounds top weight.
Yeah, how much money have you got on?
£300, even money, but there it is. Someone was offering 2-1, I was told, for... You know, you get 2-1 for Roy, but I've been around, I can't find it, you know.
You've got £300 on the match?
Three. I lost five last time. That was it. But I've got some friends of mine that are putting a lot of money on, but apparently McLean's the favourite, you know. It's, then every man to his own, what's it called, but, you know, Roy'll do him.
The fight is said to be in aid of charity, and it's being promoted by two relatives of Lenny McLean's who run a vending machine business in Islington. The average ticket price has brought them a gate of about £20,000, and money's also being raised by selling programmes at 40 pence each. They contain no text or photographs, and are almost exclusively lists of adverts for local pubs. Hiring the hall tonight has cost £1,500, and there'll be another £2,000 to pay in fees for the other boxers.
Mr. Warren, it looks as if your gate's something like £20,000 or so. What proportion of that goes to the children's muscular dystrophy and autistic children's charities?
Well, we don't know the exact amount of the charity tonight, but after expenses, they get a fair proportion of it. You know, we're only working on expenses, that's all. After all the expenses are paid out, the rest will go to muscular dystrophy.
But what sort of proportion of the gate tonight?
It depends on what we take it. You know, I can't tell you what amount it is until we see what the actual take is for the night. I mean, there's still people coming in now. How do we know what the take is?
The Boxing Board of Control haven't always approved of the sort of medical attention unlicensed fights have had in the past. But tonight, after all the recent publicity, the promoters have managed to secure the services of a casualty officer from the Westminster Hospital.
Doctor, what kind of physical shape is he in, do you think?
Well, excellent physical shape. Because we can tell here that this examination facility is a fine. They are all fine.
Are you actually approved and licensed by the British Boxing Board of Control for this sort of examination?
No, I'm not. But I am a fully registered medical practitioner in this country. And I was asked to attend, so I am.
How experienced are you in treating boxers?
Well, boxers, we do see them. I'm not specifically a boxing specialist.
That's why they call me Daddy Cole. Look at me. Air before a fight. Cool as a cucumber.
That's why I've got to win. Must win. They will come second.
I know I'm a lot older than him, but that won't make no difference. You'll soon see. I've got a bigger heart than he's got. He's got a yellow streak down his leg.
How skillful do you think this kind of boxing really is?
Well, it all depends, you know. Yeah, just 2 minutes having a fight. Daddy cool, 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 daddy
Ladies and gentlemen, the main contest of the evening, the mean machine himself, boy, pretty boy.